call the meeting to order. You're all present in the conic floor. Would everyone stand, if so inclined? Rob will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. So, any additions, deletions, changes to the agenda?
We do have a couple additions. They are scholarships. We have two scholarships to add. I believe Lori put them at your here. One would be the Smiles Scholarship, and one is the Keith Meyer Scholarship.
Okay, we will entertain that items 3 and 4 under new business. Anything else?
No, not for me.
Okay. If not, I would look for a motion to approve the agenda with the changes made.
Mm-hmm.
Motion
I'll
by second. Kurt, seconded by Rob. Other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That is carried. Schedule presenters. Schoolology team is here.
Schoology.
All right.
We get money to make our tomato. A dime goes in
the jar. I was the Winona County Spelling Bee champion in
the first grade.
But I cannot phonetically answer some things. So that's one of them. Okay. Team, would you like to come up?
Sure. I think I'll be your Vanna White. And then you all want to kind of just, whatever, kind of speak to your stuff as I'm. Whenever you want to go front or however you want to do it.
You guys do rehearse. Then you can be on the camera.
Of course.
I want to
just rehearse. Sounds like it's going to be kind of rough. No rehearsals.
Is there a rehearsal pads?
So one of the things that I hope you notice is that the boardroom has changed a little bit. And this is one of our, we've added whatever, a large 75-inch television. And new laptop, and the reason why we're also doing this in here is this is actually a possibility for what a future classroom might have for a screen. A lot of LCD projectors are kind of going by the wayside, and I don't want to say they're a dead technology, but they're kind of on their way out. Smart boards are also kind of in that role as well. So this is actually one of the possibilities for the replacement for teacher classrooms is a large TV. There's also touchscreen TVs, and if you watch any of the news and things like that, you'll actually notice that, and a lot of them are using that. So we're actually talking about this kind of being our next gen kind of look.
So is that a touchscreen?
This is not a touchscreen. Okay. No, we decided not to do that. It's a hefty investment, a touchscreen. Yeah, it is. So anyhow, tonight I'm Amy Dombeck, and I'm the Director of Instructional Technology. And I have with me Sarah Minnie and Chris Sampson, who are from the elementary school, and Ann Davison and Amanda Thompson from the high school and middle school. And they're going to speak to technology tools that they use in the classroom and also to Schoology. Before doing that, I just wanted to speak to a couple of lingo things. Mm-hmm. So LMS versus SMS. LMS is a learning management system. And it's basically where teachers organize what goes on in the classroom, the content. They organize that. It communicates learning through an LMS. Our LMS in Cannon Falls is Schoology. That's where we organize our learning. And there's lots of different ways that people are using it. You'll hear about the teachers here who are using Schoology, kindergarten all the way through high school. An SMS is a student management system, and that's where we actually organize data. And we have a lot of data that we have to communicate to, in particular, the state. We have to do a lot of data reporting. We might have to report if somebody's graduated or the credits that they're supposed to have, GPA, things like that. That's an SMS. That's a student management system. And our student management system at Cannon Falls is Infinite Campus. How we're using these has changed a little bit, and we can talk about that at another time. A lot of grading used to go on in Infinite Campus at the high school. We're kind of switching over and starting to look at Schoology a little bit more in its grade book And then just using that to report earned credits and things like that through Infinite Campus. The elementary school is also starting to explore that a little bit, but not as much. They're kind of in the waiting pool, maybe some of them, maybe even in, you know, kind of just getting their feet wet with Schoology. So traditional classroom versus blended classroom. Traditional classroom, I think we all get that. We're all in rows, teachers up front, delivering the content or whatever. They basically set everything up. In a blended classroom, you have not only that traditional classroom look, but now you have things like cooperative learning, you have project-based learning, you have students using tech tools, collaborating online and sharing, and you're seeing a lot more of this go on in our district. And so each of the teachers today are going to speak to their use of tech tools at Cannon Falls Schools. So we're going to start with Sarah Menny, who's in kindergarten, and she actually has what is called a Powtoon. And I'll get this all set up for you here. It's loading the awesomeness player, if you can't see that in the back, so that's kind of fun. All right. So
I'm Sarah Menny, like Amy said, and I teach kindergarten here in Cannon Falls. So first I just want to talk a little bit about Schoology and how we're using it. This is the first year that we are really trying to implement Schoology as much as we can. But first, for us in kindergarten, it's not only an introduction to students, but it's an introduction to parents as well. Especially we have a lot of parents, this is their first student in Cannon Falls Elementary. Mm-hmm. And so it's our job not only to get the students used to it, but to the parents as well.
What did you want to do this? Sorry,
yeah.
My bad. I turned the letter early. Sorry.
And we've been playing around a little bit with how we can use Schoology as assessments. As you'll hear in the older grades, that they use Schoology quite a bit with their assessments. Kindergarten students aren't yet able to independently take those assessments on the computer. However, with Schoology, they have a function that's an audio function. So I'm hoping by the end of this year, I've been playing around with it, I can record my voice reading the question to them. So even if they can't read all those words, they are able to push the play button, hear the question, and then answer. So again, it's something that we can use just to get students used to Schoology. So when they go on next year and they're using it more independently, they already know the interface. Mm-hmm. So this is what a screenshot of what my Schoology page looks like. So when parents log in, this is what they see. Right now, I use it a lot for parent communication. So I'm able to put photos up there so the parents are able to go in and see, oh, what did they do at the fun run? What did they do on their field trip? How was their fall party? Those kinds of things. I also put up copies of my newsletters and important information, like from open house or things that they should know, so they have extra copies there. And then this is also a great place to put up copies of our rubrics. So thinking about grades coming up soon, we have our grading rubrics. So we send a copy home with parents, but come second trimester, it's probably lost. So this is a great place where they can go back and refer to those again if they'd like to. So that's Schoology. Something else that we use in our classrooms is called clickers. And this is what it looks like. So we use it for assessment and quick checks. They help guide instruction, they give immediate feedback, and they are easy. So even my 5-year-old kindergartners are able to use this to answer a multiple choice question. And then it gives me real-time feedback. So if you want to go on to the next one. I have some.
And can you explain how you get the feedback?
Yes.
So the students, you ask the question, and then the students hold that up.
So I'll ask a question, like this one was a survey, and my question was, what pizza do you like? So they got to choose from pepperoni, cheese, sausage, and veggies. So if they liked pepperoni, they would hold A up. So that's the front of their card, that's what I see. For my kids, this is the back of their card, this is what they see. So they're able to see A is up, so their answer goes up. So I'm able to see, this is a screenshot of what my iPad looks like. So the blue is a survey, and it tells me all their answers. So 7 liked A, 9 was B. All right, over here on this side, this is asking a question. So the green are the ones that got it right, and the red is the one that got it wrong. So it gives me immediate feedback where I can say, okay, Tegan had troubles with her patterns question number 2. So then I can go back and individually work with her on those kinds of things later.
And this is kind of wild, but you can actually take your iPad and then scan. And then where all that data comes from is just by scanning the classroom or whatever and having the camera then record what information is posted there. So it's really clever use.
And then here it tracks it over time. So all the assessments that we've done, it lays it all out for us. So it's handy. And then finally, I just want to talk to a little bit about iPads. This year is our first year with one-to-one iPads. And they've been great for us to have in our classrooms. We are able to use them across the curriculum. So not only are we able to use them in literacy, but we can use them in math, science, and other areas as well. Social studies, we just did a unit with that, and I was able to use the iPads. We use them to practice and review skills, and they can do that independently, but we also use them as collaboration. We just got in our classrooms these little coding machines, I guess you would call them, called V-Bots. And they have an app for that on here, which they can use as a group to practice, and then when they get the actual V-Bot in front of them, they can again collaborate and use that as a tool to work together. So that's just a little bit about some of the things we're doing with technology in kindergarten.
Creative using Powtoon.
Using Powtoon. Does anyone have any questions or anything?
Just real quick, how about just when you talk about how it's interactive with the parents out there as well, do you see a lot of parents getting online? Do they understand it? Is it discussed at the conferences? You've seen a lot of usage with that by the parents?
I brought it up at conference time, and that's when I gave them their parent access code, and I kind of talked with them briefly about what Schoology is, how to log on, and how we'll be using it. I will be completely honest. I don't have my whole class. They aren't all signed up. The parents that I do have told me that they like having access to the photos and the newsletter and things that way. So my goal is to keep in my newsletters that I send out just reminder, don't forget to sign up for Schoology, and just kind of keep reminding parents that this is a great tool that we use.
And one thing that I'm going to do a better job of, because here's the reality about Schoology, once parents are in the system, they're in the system for the rest of the student's career here at Cannon Falls Schools. So we're going to do a better job next year of trying to help kind of generate that enthusiasm, maybe at open house, kind of getting parents logged on and helping them feel like supported or whatever. That's one area that I'll tell you, I didn't think that through or whatever. But we're going to work on that, because if we can get them there, then we have them the whole rest of the way through. So.
How about the iPads? The kids have them.
Mm-hmm.
Do they leave the school with them?
Nope, iPads stay in the classroom. Yep, and we have social stories and charts and things that we've talked about how we appropriately handle them, but nope, they definitely don't leave the classroom.
So is it changing really the way you're teaching?
Mm-hmm. Yep, it's giving us a lot more, especially the iPads, a lot more tools that we can use to give them different ways to learn. So a lot of times before, we were limited to what we could do in the classroom, and there's those learners who have fine motor struggles. So sitting down and practicing writing their name, they did not like that at all. So now on the iPad, it's not so much a focus on those fine motor skills, but they can use a finger, and they can trace and draw and practice that way. So they're still learning about those letters and their letter names, but they're not being held back by their fine motor struggles that they may have. That's just one example.
Very good. Thank you. Appreciate that. So next we have Chris Sampson. Chris is a fifth grade teacher, and he's going to speak to the way that he uses tech tools and Schoology as well. So.
All right, so mine isn't quite as fancy as...
mine isn't either. Thanks for
Anyhow, I'm Chris Sampson. I teach fifth grade now at the elementary. This is actually my third year now with one-to-one in my room and third year with Schoology. Every year it gets easier. I feel, you know, like our team is very on board, especially with the turnover we've had and just the amount of new things we've kind of had sent our way. We've really adapted well. And Schoology is obviously kind of the heartbeat of my classroom now, really. And I think back, like, I don't know how I did it without it, because it's just been so easy to adapt to it. I mean, it's a lot of work, but once you've got it, it's there, and you're not, you know, reprinting and recopying and recreating. I mean, I've got everything now on here, and every year now I've just been adding to it and just putting more and more, you know, information up there for my kids. But anyways, this is kind of just a quick screenshot of what my homepage looks like. I have split mine up into all of my subjects, as well as the specialists have added folders to it. And basically, the expectation by them is that when they get to school, their iPad needs to be charged. Well, they need to have it with them. It needs to be charged. And they are going to be using it for pretty much every subject. You know, I still have to argue with some of my kids about, you know, they're bringing it home, forgetting it, and things like that. But it's just, it's kind of like a textbook. Sometimes they have it, sometimes they don't. When they don't, they find out how challenging their day is going to be, because I still expect them to get the work done. And I'm not always so nice about letting them borrow my iPad. But, you know, on assessments and things, they need to have it so they can get through. But anyways, I have everything broken up into two folders. So, you know, they get there in the morning, they click on their DSR, that's their daily spiral review. It's just, it's morning math work that they do. And then it's kind of nice because if I have a student that's gone, they can still keep up. I can have them log into Schoology. They can access all of our math notes. They can access all of our social studies and science notes. So if they're gone, they can still, if they're feeling up to it, work from home and stay caught up. All of my parents do have access to the gradebook portion of Schoology, so I have a few that are very in tune as to how their child is doing, and I have others that are, you know, kind of still pushing away from it, and I just tell them, like, well, you know, it's not going to go away, so it's just something to get used to. But anyhow, what's nice about this is the past year and a half, my team has really push the assessment portion of Schoology, so we are all focusing on common math assessment and reading assessments, so we now have all of our math assessments on Schoology, with the exception of one geometry test, because it's just not, we cannot find a way to put it on there. But anyhow, so all of our students are doing common assessments in math and reading, which really makes it nice. It saves on paper, and it also cuts down on time grading. I remember coming home with stacks and stacks of papers to grade. Schoology does a bulk of my grading for me, except for my short answer essay questions. It does a bulk of the grading, and I get immediate feedback right away, and so do my students. As soon as they submit a math test, they can see the results, with the exception of those short answer fill-in-the-blank questions that it can't grade. They can also upload content and share with their classmates. It's limited as to what they can do, but we do have kind of like a wall, sort of like we got on Facebook. It's really nice because I see, you know, I can read everything they post on there. But, you know, at night they're, you know, commenting to each other on, you know, a math assignment or, hey, dude, what do we need to do for social studies? You know, it's kind of nice to see them actually using this outside of school. So, you know, it's a great way for them to communicate, and it's a safe way to communicate. So,
okay.
Go to the next one.
Yep.
Assessment in Schoology, this is just kind of a sample of what a multiple choice math question would look like. This is the teacher view, so the student view is going to be cleaner, it won't have all the stuff around the side. Like I said, all of our math assessments are now common across our grade level. And when they're done, as soon as they're done submitting their assignments, I can start seeing their scores immediately. I can see how long they spent on each problem. I can see like a general grade until I actually, you know, grade the short answer multiple choice ones on my own. But I can get an idea of what our class average is. And it breaks it up by students. So when parents, you know, are in the conferences and, hey, you know, really struggle with this math test. Oh, well, he took it in 12 minutes, you know. So it's kind of nice to be able to show this to parents. And it also saves me a lot of time and allows me time to prep for other things and not sit and grade math assignments. Another thing we do, digital agendas. I'm like probably one of the biggest advocates of this. I know some of my team hasn't quite gotten into this, but that's all right. I really like it. A coworker of mine last year was into it as well, and her and I kind of tag teamed on getting our kids used to this digital agenda. So basically, we got rid of the paper agendas in my classroom. So instead of buying one from the office, which some of them still have, my students log into their iPad and they have an app called My Homework. My end of it's called Teachers IO. But this allows them to see everything they have for homework. So throughout the day when I assign a math assignment, I'll post it in here. If I have a reading assignment, I'll post it in here. Some of my coworkers are like, well, shouldn't they be responsible for, you know, having to write that down? My thought is right now I'm just wanting them to get their homework done. So they have no excuse to not know that they have it done because it goes directly to their agenda. Even if they don't have internet at home, they can still see this. As long as they sync it before they leave the building, which most of them automatically sync, because I do have two students without internet, they can go home and click on this and see exactly what they have due tomorrow or when their next upcoming test is. And their parents also have access to this. So nothing is a surprise for most of those parents, or shouldn't be a surprise anyways, because it's all on there. And then if I goof up, then I take responsibility for, oh, I forgot to push a math assignment in, which doesn't ever happen. But, you know, it's just, they kind of think it's neat to think that if I mess up, they go off the hook. But I like it. It's a free app. I've been using it now for, Jenny Johnson, I got 2.5 years ago, actually. A guy at one of our workshops was showing it to us, and then so last year we really kind of implemented it right in the beginning of the year. And it's kind of nice. So it's just it's our virtual agenda. Nearpod is another program I use. This is a presentation program. This is a free app as well. I've been using this now for 3 years. Ever since my kids were able to get iPads, this is one thing that I really worked at. I know Mr. Bell's seen me use it in my class a few times with my kids. What Nearpod does is it allows the kids to see on their iPads what I'm presenting on my board. So I create a PowerPoint, I upload it to Nearpod, and when I turn the Nearpod on, it gives them a password to type in or like a key code. So they go onto the Nearpod app, type that in, everything that I've got pulled up shows up on their screen. So when we're doing science notes or social studies notes, they're not, because for some of them, just seeing the board is hard, or you know, the ones that struggle with, you know, vision, it's right in front of them, and then I can pace it so they can't like, flip too far ahead and get too far into their notes, but they can see everything right there. Also, it's really nice for pictures. You know, they can zoom in on different maps and things. So I've been using this now, like I said, for a few years, and it works great. Before, I used PowerPoint, which is a little more cumbersome, but Nearpod allows me to take an old PowerPoint and basically drag and drop it in there, and it shows up, and they can get on it. So it's a neat app, and it's also free. So at least it's still free so far. Renaissance, I use this, we use it for everything. This is what our students AR test on, and then STAR test. I haven't had to sign up for a computer lab to STAR test now in 2 years, because I want my students doing it on their iPads. I want them to be prepared for down the road when possibly MCAs are done on, you know, their devices, getting used to navigating the screen. Obviously, you know, their STAR reading tests are, you know, much shorter than MCA, but it just gives them that kind of feel for what assessment is like on a device. And then I don't need to worry about waiting for, you know, 3 days to get into the lab to test. I can just have my students pull them out, test, and then when they're done, they can move on to something else. And so anyways, I do STAR testing monthly on the iPads just to give my parents kind of feedback, gives RTI feedback where my kids are at. If I got one that's kind of falling behind, helps me kind of progress monitor a little bit with them. And then they obviously can do their AR testing on here as well, which is a nice time saver. I remember my first year having an AR test on the two computers in my room. It took forever. They can pull up an AR test on their iPad, and you know, they can do that in between assignments and whenever they have some free time. So it works well. This is what the STAR data looks like on the iPad. So this is my class list. This is this is their November results. So we base all of their reading goals off of, you know, how they do on their STAR reading test. Gives me immediate feedback, gives them immediate feedback, and then, that's right. No problem. And then it also breaks them up into my reading groups. So I teach with literacy groups in my class and work with novels, and this helps me break down my readers, and then it's obviously constantly changing as the kids, you know, hopefully grow. But it's really nice. So Renaissance is very, very user-friendly on the iPads, and I haven't had a problem with it. And last but not least, I am starting to work on different STEM activities. Mr. Bell and I have been working with my class on using these Sphero robotic balls. They are super bizarre, but they are cool. And my kids are really digging them, and now they're bugging me to use them more. And they're all controlled from the iPad, so it's basic programming. I just bought a bunch of materials now to have them create little maze courses in the room, and they're going to have to program this ball to move through it without touching the barriers. So it's kind of a neat thing, just starting it, so it's going to take some time, but it kind of gives them a chance to use the iPads for something other than just testing or just doing notes. It's kind of been fun, and this is actually, we were just working on them a few weeks ago, and they were bugging me just to, hey, about when we're going to get them back out again. So it's kind of neat to be able to use them for that. And then obviously with Lego Robotics, when I was working with Care Sleep last year, the new Mindstorm robots are all now compatible with iPads. So instead of having to haul a bunch of laptops down to Rochester, kids can do all the programming from the iPads, portable. And again, it's just another use for them to keep our kids comfortable and using these devices. So I think that's it. Are there any questions? I know I probably talked too long.
You know, I don't know the question, but the assessments, I mean, you speak a lot about the assessments, which I'm really impressed with. Mm-hmm. With the feedback, with the timeliness of it all, where do you see the assessments going? I mean, it sounds like you do it a lot.
It sounds like a lot. And I mean, it was a lot to put together. Mm-hmm. I mean, my team spent hours upon hours creating our math assignments, going back and looking at what the standards are really asking for. It was amazing how much stuff we were able to get rid of, but then how much stuff we didn't have, which I think is why the fifth grade math scores are continuing to go up, is because we're finding these things that we were missing and getting rid of the things we didn't need. Yeah. And it's just really been beneficial. And then to be able to put them on, you know, Schoology, it takes time. But then once they're there, you know, I can pull the same math assignment up every year. And, you know, we'll go back through them and we try to meet, you know, in our PLCs. And, you know, if one particular question, you know, if only 20% of the fifth graders got it right on this test, we're looking at the question and, all right, is it worded poorly? Is it not accurately written or whatever? And so we're constantly able to reevaluate our assessments. And, I mean, it is a lot of work, but in the long run, it makes the job so much easier.
One of the things I want to speak to, too, because of the PLC process, not all assessments are graded. Some of the assessments are just a snapshot about what's going on in the classroom. And mm-hmm. maybe he would, and talked about this, only 20% of the kids got it right. Well, maybe I need to go back and reteach that. So it maybe wasn't graded.
Right.
Kid didn't get a score for it, but it's feedback for teachers so that they know what's going on.
Yeah, I do that daily now with my math. As soon as they get in the room, they do a quick check, which is part of the math curriculum. I just digitize it and put it on the iPad. And that gives me an idea of what I taught yesterday. Oh, boy, we really need to go over this. Or, oh, wow, they're really catching on. We can move on. It's usually a 3 or 4 question assessment. I don't grade them, but it just gives me an idea of what they're doing and how well they're getting the material presented to them. And then they move on and watch their video for the upcoming math assignment, which I also have all the videos on there, too. So it is slick. And but, yeah, it's a lot of work, but once you kind of get into the groove of it, it's kind of fun to see how much, you know, you really can do with these things. And, you know, every year it just seems to get better. So.
Awesome.
Yeah. Excellent. Thanks.
All right.
Thank you.
Next we have Ann Davison, and Ann actually teaches both at the middle school and the high school levels. And she's going to speak to how she uses Schoology and technologies.
I teach 8th grade English and 10th grade English in the first semester, and then I have a high school math media second semester. I'm so glad I didn't have to teach through the election.
Mm-hmm.
But I have been using Schoology for 3 years now, but this is my first year one-to-one, which I felt like was a bit of a, well, I thought it would be a challenge, and it hasn't been, but the students that I have, the current 8th graders, they were the first students to get their device. So these students have had devices for that long, and here I am, the newbie, and I'm like, oh, they've got all the ins and the outs. I know they're going to use these things for evil and not good. Before Schoology, I jumped on the bandwagon of having a class website, and I used it to post what we did in the day. You know, if you were there, if you were part of our class, you knew what my little cryptic notes were, and parents could kind of see, oh, that's a short story unit, or this is that. And then I would include links. Most of everything that I had is either make it or find it online, and there's a link to it. So I was a little bit nervous because the change scares me. I'm sure I'm the only person in here who gets fearful of change, but I know that about myself. And when Schoology came around, I said, okay, here we go again. And so the course, the way I organize my course, I use updates, and that's just a kind of like a news feed.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure other people don't use them. I'm sure people use them in a different way, but I use it the way I used my web page, where I would post the dates and what we did that day and any resources that we used. And so this is an example of my 10th grade class.
One of my favorite things is making pictures that have nothing to do with my unit. And I'm in the, whatever this is called, my, whatever that is, that's my dog sprinting. That's Sammy sprinting. I like to change it and see who notices. So this is one way, we were going through some writing and paper in my 10th grade group. So I was saying, this is what we is due today, this is what we're doing in class, and this is what you need tomorrow. I will say this is one of my most organized days. I was really good that week. And then in the end, they were working on this paper, and this, I created the rubric, and I used the Schoology program to make a rubric, which is fantastic. They upload a paper, which they've done on Google Docs already. They just pull it from Google Docs. It syncs with Schoology. And then I click on the student's name, read the paper online. I can make highlights and notes, but then I click on this icon and my rubric pops up. And I can go, you did that great, that was stinky, that was all right, and click, 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 click. And I can make comments. And really, when you get to the final paper, the rubric is just basically the answers to the test. So if they want to come and see why they got a 2 or a 2.5 and not a 3, I'm telling you right there why, but this is posted way before they ever have to hand in the paper. This is just a recap of what we've been talking about all these days. So it shouldn't be new news, and if it is, where you been? That's what I So another way I use to organize my courses with materials, and I am a very visual person, and maybe I noticed this from Amy, but I learned how to insert photos, pictures, to give a visual of what each folder is about, because I wasn't always happy with the color choices of the folders. So I have general information, and then I learned that I can, when I edit that file, I can kind of put information, like if you look in here, you'll find this. Because I think it would be very overwhelming for a parent, a student, because the way I organize things, I know this is news to a lot of people, might not be the same way you organize things. And to be honest, from year to year, I don't understand why I organize something. So I try to be as transparent as I possibly can. So so this one is you can go and you can find any graphic organizer you ever want. A lot of the things we're doing with organizing their thinking is transferable to pretty much anything they read, any class they read. They could grab that and do a graphic organizer, compare and contrast in their history class. They could grab that from there. So here's a research essay folder. So everything you have to do for the research essay, you're going to find it here. Well, there's a lot there, so I tried to break it down into bits and pieces there. So, and then I'm big into low-stakes writing, where the kids can just write and not have to be judged on what they're saying, how it's coming out, the sentence structure. Just write. And so I've always had notebooks, and my room has been full of a bucket of notebooks. That's just part of it. Go get your notebooks, go do this. And I just kind of stepped into the water with a Schoology this year, and I am not going back. I actually handed the kids notebooks back and said, take these, and I explained very clearly that they weren't going to need them. What are we going to do with these now? Take them home. They don't. So we're doing all our journals on here, and for example, I will create an assignment, and I can make the assignment just a completion. I can give it points. I can see what they've done. I can go through and read it. Sometimes I do, sometimes I don't. Today we did a journal on, we watched a Twilight Zone, not just because we were tired and it was Monday. It's to teach them about short story terms and plot, the plot curve and things. And the theme was time enough at last. And so I had them journal, what would you do if you had all the time in the world? Then there was another one they could choose. And then I said, if you want to just go to images and Google time, and if you find a poster or a quote, that has to do with time and you want to just paste it on your Google Docs, go for it. And it's the versatility and the student choice. I said, how many of you grabbed a journal from the internet or a prompt or a quote? And maybe 3, 4, 5 in a class would. Some would do it differently. But the cool thing about this is the kids aren't just learning about journal writing. They are learning about how to make a folder in Google Docs. And we assume that these kids have grown up with the internet and with technology. They don't know how to make a folder in Google Docs. And they don't know how to make a folder within a folder in Google Docs. And when you're in that other folder, they don't know how to make another document. And they know about their technology, but certain things. In a journal, I taught them how to insert a line. See me after if you're interested. highlight. And so there's other things happening, not just Schoology. So this was a cool thing that happened. So this was my folder for eighth grade metaphor. You can find things about extended metaphor in there. Use a thing from Jerry Seinfeld, Life is a Ride. So he said, life is a ride. And I said, okay, now create your own metaphor. So this was the assignment. Or no, I created a discussion. And the cool thing is that it's got to be user-friendly for me to do it, and I thought of this idea during class. So I was able to go just in class. That's where my best ideas go. That was supposed to be funny. And I just said, hey, you guys, let's try to do this. And I typed it up. And this they had already done in an assignment, at the bottom of an assignment. And so they have it set so that if you once you add to the discussion, then you can start seeing others. So I said, write your metaphor down. Look at others, comment, add some more. After you've written a creative one on your own, if you want to add some from the internet, you can. And you can see, I can see who responded, I can see who commented, and this was my favorite. I hope the kid did grab this from the internet, because I just want him to have written it himself. Life is a phone. As you mature, your personality changes, so do your apps. First you want to kids game, and then you want social media, and then you want a news app, but at the end you buy a bingo game till your phone dies. That was awesome. So my classroom has changed, and I'm stepping back, and I'm finding that my role as a teacher is changing, and I like it. I am, as Amy says, a guide on the side rather than a sage on the stage, and it's like, oh, this is different, but it's the way education needs to go. I need to get out of the way and be helping them find their choices and their voices, and I need to cheer them along. So all this is helping us do that.
Good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Amanda Thompson teaches high school science,
specifically biology.
Specifically biology, yes.
All right. So...
My bad.
Sorry. How about you, Schoology? I don't remember what I said. But the organization of my course, I do know this. I organize it by unit, but I also have a follow the date policy. So if students are like, I don't know, we're doing biology, well, what day is it today? Look at your folder, look at the date, and you follow the dates to find out where you need to go. And I found that that's been very helpful, because one of the challenges sometimes being a high school teacher is that there's all these amazing opportunities that students have to go places during the school day and miss your class. And so this really is a great way for them to be able to get the information and to access what they need, or to say, hey, check this folder and you'll find what you need. And so that's one of the great things about Schoology is to have all those resources in one place so they can get them if they need them. I have all my courses organized with the unit objectives and vocabulary right at the beginning. So at the beginning, students should know what they need to know by the time we get to the end. It's there the whole time. I don't know how many of them actually look at it, but I say it at the beginning and all throughout. And then after that, then it's all of the things that we do to help learn the material that's there. I don't necessarily put all my assignments and assessments in Schoology. I'm not one that does a lot of my assessments that way. There's a variety of reasons. It takes a lot of time to input questions into it, and in biology, pictures are very important to the questions, and so that takes even more time. So I do use them somewhat, but not entirely. But I have transitioned to being providing at least one or maybe two review quizzes that I don't grade, but they're in there. Students at any point in the unit can use them to review, go over concepts, and get ready for the assessments that we do have. So I found that to be very useful. Some other things that I've incorporated, having Schoology and some other pieces there, is one of the nice things, and when we got the devices, my opinion on giving students textbooks to take home changed decidedly. I still have them in the classroom for use, but why carry a book and your tablet around? That doesn't make a lot of sense. So, at least in my biology class, we didn't have an online textbook, but there's this CK12 resource that is out there. It's free. It's decent, and the really good part is it's editable. I can go and take what they've got and then tweak it with information that I also think is critical or that matches our state standards, and so I can really customize it, and they can take it with them wherever they go. With my AP course, they still have a book, but there's also an online textbook as well, and that's really nice because, as Miranda can attest, it's a heavy book, and carting it around with you everywhere is kind of a challenge, so having it on the accessible on the tablets is really useful.
Have you run into problems with kids not having internet at home?
No one's really said that to me, or they do, they're maybe just not using it, but no one has said that that's a big issue.
I'm working on a grant right now that allows hotspots to go home with kids, and I think we're going to be able to get that. But I think that would help in situations like this, because this is great resources, but if they don't have that accessibility at home, you know, after surveying our kids, we're still at about 12% of our population doesn't have internet. So
I know that's one thing that Schoology, too, at the conference this summer was talking about that, about how to get that Schoology content on the device so you don't even need the internet. So that's another ask, you know, but that's probably a little bit down the way. So anyhow.
But happily, we still have books.
Yeah.
Yes.
Absolutely. Another aspect of this, too, is that with Schoology, there's a lot of great resources out there. Like, I would love to do all of my own videos and, like, be able to explain all these biology concepts, and I can do some of that, but I'm no good with animation. Like, I'm not going to make some really cool animation myself. There's a lot of good stuff out there. One that I use sometimes is the Amoeba Sisters. A lot of the key of biology content, it's a nice overview. If students miss something in class, they can use it. If what I said didn't make sense, they could go there, and it just adds another perspective on the same topic, which I find to be really nice. So it's been really good for resources like that that I can pull. And personally, I like to, curate what students are using as a resource. They can Google a topic just fine, but they don't always get something that's quality. And so if I can put resources on Schoology that are what they need to be looking at, then I think that's worthwhile. Another thing, this right here is an online evolution lab that I found and started using last year. I also have a couple biotech virtual labs that I use. Some of those things are difficult to do in the classroom or take really long periods of time. So having some virtual lab resources we can do right on the tablet that I don't have to go to the computer lab for is excellent. So I've been using those a lot as well. A new tool that I used for the first time last week, super easy, was this one, the Screencast-O-Matic, and that's where I'm starting to learn how to make my own videos so that if I have to be gone and they really need to on this day learn about this topic, hear it in my voice, I can do that. And it's kind of speaking to that idea of that whole flipped classroom or blended learning. I don't necessarily have to go get somebody else's video, now I can put my own stuff together. And I'm hoping to use that more in a lot of different ways. And then there's a ton of these kind of things out there. There's Kahoot, there's Quizalize I've used, Quiziz, our review type games for material. I often use them before tests. And at least for Kahoot, question pops up on the screen. The four choices are there. They use their device, pick what they want. They're competing against each other. And it's usually an enjoyable way to review content, but also compete with your classmates. And it's timed, and yeah. So it's kind of fun. So I'm really excited about what we're doing with devices and Schoology. I can remember saying to myself 8-10 years ago, wouldn't it be nice if we could? Wouldn't it be great if? And some of those things that I was wanting to do back then, we can do now because we have these resources. So we have, so many more resources available in the classroom. You don't have to go to the computer lab. With both student and parent access, everybody can get what they need when they want to, and there's instantaneous communication. I put a quiz score in, boom. 2 minutes later, somebody's walking in, hey, I saw that I got this on the quiz. Yes, you did, you're right. So you can talk about that immediately, which is excellent. Also, the ability to respond to lots of different needs, getting resources or differentiating something like, this group, you're going to do this bit of work. This group, you're going to do this. That's doable on Schoology. And being able to have timeliness and get around some of the logistical issues that used to exist when you didn't have that resource readily available. And as a result, I really have been trying to slowly shift my teaching to more of that blended learning format and not always be up there speaking, for a long time, and then people are doing problems over here, but we're doing a lot of different things, and it's pretty exciting.
Cool. Any questions?
Just in general, then, when you look at, and this is for everybody, you have your programs, you have your apps that you use. It's kind of like you take that as that's your lesson plan, the way you go about doing things, is that right? Where, I guess my question is, in a positive way, can you take that and look at other teachers and their lesson plans and say, hey, this works for us, this doesn't. Our kids are doing better because of this application. I mean, are we able to use that? Or, you look at continuity, like maybe for through fifth grade, even sixth grade, it's like, are we consistent in how we teach, and is the way we teach, are we doing this in such a fashion that we're seeing positive results? And if not, is it because of the way so-and-so teaches, this teacher teaches this way? And
that
what
is,
I'm saying?
That is part of our PLC process. What you're describing there, that's exactly what people wonder, what are teachers doing? We're not having cart races up and down the hallway when the school and the kids are on, right? No, we're actually digging into what we do, the art and the craft of teaching. That's what you're speaking to.
Yeah.
That maybe in physical therapy, maybe there's a treatment that works better for certain people, for certain body types, whatever it might be, that's what those kind of conversations that we're having on PLC days. So you're attuned to what we're doing, what we're trying, and getting feedback from technology. This is helping inform our practice much more readily in a way that we didn't have before. Okay. So
presentations are just great.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Very informative.
Thank you. Very good.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. I have a question for you.
Yes.
How long before the computer lab goes away if all these folks are saying they really don't need it?
No, that's
well,
not true. Because
funny you should say that.
Yeah. Just
This is actually something we're going to be speaking to at the tech committee meeting. And the reality about replacing a lab is it's about $36,000 to $40,000 to replace a lab. We can buy an awful lot of Chromebooks for $36,000 to $40,000. Have extra, maybe even laying around.
No, I mean just.
But the lab facilities itself. Think about that. We have four labs, so four times 36,000. That's a lot of. We're going to have to start thinking differently about how we're using the devices that we have with our students already.
Especially if they're already not having to go to the lab.
Absolutely.
They already have access.
Absolutely.
On the pads.
We do have some issues though. We have some courses that we cannot put the programs they need, in particular CAD, computer assisted design, coming from Mr. Pliscott's classroom, that cannot go. MCA testing, we got to make sure that we have the right devices.
Right, right.
iPads, we're probably going to have to look at maybe getting Chromebooks to have kids take MCA testing on, because we're not even sure if the iPads will work on that. So there's some conversations that are actually going to be happening next month. That's very interesting you speak to that. And in the next couple of months or whatever, as we start to transition and think about how we're using them, getting a good bang for buck, if you will. So
right.
Thank
right.
you all for listening.
Yeah. I'm sorry.
Oh,
do you see an issue with, Amanda, you're more maybe using iPads more specific than even pencil to paper, eyes to page. Do you see any changes or difficulties with kids where they're not putting that pencil to paper and learning that way, where you hear some things about that where
well,
it could be?
That's where, when I make decisions about how I'm going to do things in class, I definitely use tablets more than I did, but there are some things that we do that I want them to use to put pencil to paper. And so I specifically design it that way that, you're going to need to draw this thing out, or you need to do it this way, because they're not a solution for everything, but they're a great piece of the puzzle.
Yeah.
You know, over the last couple of years, we've kind of pushed toward more technology, more one-to-one initiative information. For me, this has been about the most comprehensive thing I've looked at. And I know you guys in particular, tech and curriculum, were saying, how are we doing, how are we implementing this? But that was impressive.
Mm-hmm. Yep. That was very well put together.
How's everybody else doing with it?
That happened.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, everybody else. The other
teachers. Yeah, it varies. Everybody's in a different place, but we're just all trying to move forward in some way.
We help each other out. Mm-hmm. People kind of step up or rise to the top of people know who to go to and for various questions for tech help. Or it's just kind of how we roll. We help each other.
So when we get people that are different with their technology expertise, you are able as a group to be pulling everyone forward.
Yeah, with a tech adoption, it looks kind of like a bell curve. First, you have your early adopters, people are gung ho to get in on it, and I want that new device and whatever. Then there's some people that are like, oh, I want to do whatever they're doing in their classroom. You will always have tech resistors. Like, and I love my father, but he will never have a smartphone, ever. Flip phone we call it the dumb phone. The flip phone is what he still has, and he is perfectly content and happy if he could still have the cord phone and then never have to move away from that. Life would be good. But there's always going to be that. The trick is how do we model this to our students who have to go into a world of work? My husband paints cars for a living, but uses a computer to do it. That is the reality of our world, and 70% of all the jobs in the state of Minnesota by 2020 will require a post-secondary degree, much of which is going to involve the use of technology. So even in those trades, we're still going to need people to know how to use technology. So we want to support that as much as possible. And we do what we can. If you're going to resist, that's fine. But I will say this, it's taken a long time to steer, I would say, the ship. Kind of grab hold of the rudder and push it. I think we're in a really, really good direction right now. And the elementary school has been really, really good about jumping on board. And I'm really happy to get down there and work with them. So, yeah.
All right. Well, congratulations to all of you. That was,
Thank you.
A very impressive presentation.
Thank you.
I look forward to next year's presentation. Yeah.
We're bringing the dog and pony show. We'll go old school.
We're actually doing it quarterly.
Oh, quarterly. All right. Next quarter.
Thank you.
Raise
your hand.
This is Case. I
have
a 7:30 meeting at St. Olaf for a group project.
It's
25% of my grade.
I still miss you.
May I give my student report quickly?
This is a miss.
Absolutely. That's an easy decision.
Are we not that important?
I don't know.
We don't give her grades.
That's true.
We'll give her an A if she's right.
Yeah, okay. So it's kind of that in-between time where a lot of winter sports are starting. But One Act Crew has a really great start. They just did their casting for their show of Lockdown. Novice and JV debate is just wrapping up. They have their state tournament at this Friday and Saturday. FFA is going to their U of M invite. The BPA folks are working hard. Their crew of broadcast producers just interviewed Caitlin Smith, so that's super cool before their regional contest. And NHS rang the bell for the Salvation Army and did the Feed My Starving Children thing. The bell ringing got around $800, so we thought that was a pretty good job. And then speech just started this afternoon as our first call-out meeting. Mm-hmm. So thank you, guys.
Thank you. And walking out the door, speech just began. Did that include sign-up, or was that before?
Sign-up was before, for the first time ever had a Wheel of Winter sports meeting.
How are those numbers?
Numbers are good for speech. Numbers are so good that Vandy didn't even, run around the school being like, join speech, like he usually does. It was kind of impressive.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Be careful. 70s or 80s.
Thanks, Mom.
Okay, the second item on scheduled presenters is Beth with the World's Best Workforce presentation.
Well, this seems a little unfair that I have to follow that.
I'm not going to give you a copy of the real document. It's almost complete and will be mailed, certified mail, to the state. But it is here if anyone would like to see it. There's still a few little tweaks in it, but the document is far too big for me to print for you. So what I printed tonight is somewhat of a summary. This also goes to the state, very simplified. Principals have done their parts on this. Everyone's contributed. But what I thought I would go through is just the main parts tonight. So, let's see if this will work and connect for us. It looks like it's connected back there. Okay, first of all, what goes into the world's best workforce, and this isn't on anything you have. You'll have to look up at the screen if you can't open it too small. There are so many components to this. The idea behind World's Best Workforce is to take everything that you've been working on and everything the state mandates you to do and have superintendents and teams put all of that information together. So if you look on here, even back, Kurt, you remember way back when we were working on principal evaluations and teacher evaluations and technology, the committee working on those type of things. All of those committees that you sit on and all of that information gets downput and put into one spot. So when this is finally completed by December 15th, it'll be on our web page because that's state law. The District Advisory Committee is mainly your curriculum committee, the folks you saw around the table tonight. I don't know why there's some errors in the spacing there, but that's just, Derek's kind of special, so he has to look special up
there.
That's
actually perfect for him.
Yeah. And the purpose of this committee is to recommend to the school board the district-wide educational standards, assessment, and program evaluations. A big part of this is the curriculum committee. So those of you that sit on that committee, thank you very much. One of the biggest things that we're working on is our reading proficiency. And Jen has just been doing an outstanding job as our DAC coordinator, just really thorough with her information. Everything that MD has received from her has been wonderful. You can go ahead and look at some of the things that she has downloaded in here, but I think the most important part is the district literacy goal. The reading proficiency of our special education students needs to increase by 4%. We have a lot of students that move to our district with special needs, and that is a compliment to our district. I think we service students very, very well, but with that is we need to work on their special needs and get them to where we need to be. So that is one thing we're working on. Another key point is that we're working on college readiness. The ACT indicates that Cannon Falls Schools is at 21.8. That is the same as the state score. Now you remember in the last couple of years that all students now take the ACT. So kids, whether they're going to college or not, are taking that exam. So that's a factor to take into consideration. And the district college readiness goal is the percentage of students meeting the benchmark score in all four of the college readiness subject areas will increase by 3%. That is our goal that we are submitting, and we will achieve our goal, I'm sure of it. And our last one is the achievement gap. And you hear a lot of that, and you're going to hear more of that when you go to your MSBA conference in January. It's one of the things they're going to focus on with school boards is that achievement gap. You know, what's happening between boys and girls? What's happening with students of color and not of color? What's happening with these free and reduced population versus students that, you know, are not in those categories? And so it's really important to look at those achievement gaps. Our district goal in that is the achievement gap will decrease by increasing the reading proficiency index of special education students measured by the MCA reading in April 2017. So those are our main district goals. You have been presented with the summary. This is something you may want to keep in a file somewhere because this is important. And you can certainly download this document when it's finally on our webpage. It's a resource. I don't think it's something you should go home and read. I have put my heart and soul into it, though, so if you did want to read it, that would be fine, too. But at this point, this was really designed to be a part of the standard that's required by MDE. I'm required to give you three of our goals that we're going to be working on and go from there. So this, what we're doing here is a requirement by the state. But if you do have any questions, I'd love to answer them. This will be submitted with our date tonight. This will be probably submitted on Friday to the state, and then we'll be in compliance. I tried downloading some things today, and as Lori can tell you, MD, I don't know if it was Cyber Monday or what was
closed today.
It was closed.
The power outage.
Yep.
Oh, interesting. So I couldn't submit the things I wanted to submit anyway, so they will be done this week.
Yeah. One of the things I guess that I was looking at, and Derek, we didn't get to it at the curriculum committee meeting, was about the MCAs a little bit. Was there also, I'm trying to think back, was it the third grade reading, or was it, maybe it was third grade, or was it the third grade math that was a little bit below
fourth grade
math? Okay, and was that Was that on here? Is
that,
that
that'll go more into your specific plans and your PLC plans that they individually work on.
Gotcha.
Yep, these are, this is what the state has told us. They've given us each what we need to work on. So we, this summary that's submitted is their request. This is our entire plan. This is everything that we know we need to do. The difference being is they don't have someone at the State Department to read through every single one of these. So any area that's been shown as an indicator is on here. Our graduation rate, we had students at the ALC, we had some foreign exchange students that were coded as not graduating. Well, they went back to their home country, but it made us look like we had a bad graduation rate for 1 year. So again, that's why you see some of the graduation stuff on there. So this is a document that the state is asking for specifically. This is more our plan, even our strategic plan is in here. So that if someone wanted to access anything, they could. That's the difference between the two. I just didn't see a real need for you to have this big piece of paper. Okay? So that, short and sweet, that's what I got.
Good. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Board committee reports.
I guess we had the curriculum committee meeting for this meeting. Basically, we talked a little bit about, Derek talked a little bit about the science kits that were there for Guts of the Foss science kits and how they're utilizing that. Talked about the new 6 through 12 science curriculum and that they're looking at a new curriculum coming up for that and not sure which ones they're going to go with yet. And that's all in the budget. I don't know exactly where that might be. It's maybe anywhere from $60,000 to $100,000, not sure. But that'll be up and coming. Talked a little bit about the PLC update. And also there's some discussion a little bit about gifted and talent program. Where it should start, you know, does it maybe starting as early as kindergarten? For kids that are gifted and they're exceeding already in reading and you know, how we meet the demands so that they're not there just for socialization, that they're there to also be challenged. And there'll be more discussion on that as to whether or not there might be a stipend put forth for someone, who was that, Diane?
Diane herself.
Yeah, that she would probably take on that position. And
well, she currently does, and she does get stipend.
Oh, she does, okay.
The conversation was about, you know, how do we maintain that? How do we make sure that we include that in the budget every year? And how do we maybe expand it so we can include more students and possibly older students. So.
You know, the assessment part of that has always kind of baffled me. We'd get some very active parents that start with their kids when they're 2 and 3 years old, phonetics, reading, that kind of thing. So all of a sudden when they're 5 years old, they're doing quite well. But there's a difference between a gifted and talented child and one that's just ahead of the curve. How do you deal with that?
So at our assessment conference at our gifted and talented conference we went to this summer where there was 8 of us from the elementary that went, including Diana, including Pat Bronk, our literacy coach. They recommended, along with a plethora of other schools, that we change our assessments to determine that. And we went with the COGAT test, which is a cognitive abilities test, and we give it K-5 now. Not to every student. We're not there yet. It's pretty expensive to give, but we ordered enough to where we could hit the top 10-15% of kids that were teacher-recommended and also based on other assessments that we do, use STAR, AIMS, MCA scores even, and then ESGI, which is at the younger grades. Using that data, we give this assessment, which is there's 3 different components to it, and it's not a traditional test where it's a, you know, reading, math, you know, whatever test. It's really based on critical thinking and problem solving and other things. So it gives us different data. So we can identify kids differently, that they're not just high readers, but they're actually really, they're able to think differently than other kids, which is an indicator of a gifted and talented student.
Is that a one-time assessment then, or is that assessment given to those kids throughout their school year, or the grades?
Throughout the grades, Okay. Yeah. So right now, this is our first year. We gave it to our cluster kids last spring, so our second, third, and fourth, so we could place them into classes within the cluster program for third, fourth, and fifth. This year, we've already assessed our K-1-2 students, but we just assessed our kindergarten students,
and we don't have those scores yet. So right now, currently, we're working with our high readers in kindergarten, our high readers and writers. But once we get these test scored, which I think they got scored over break and we didn't connect today, we'll determine which kids will go into that gifted and talented group with Diana in kindergarten. But we currently have that in first and second grade.
Some districts will test every single year, and some will test every other year. Remember, it's very expensive to test. So
we haven't made that decision yet. So we'll see how things go. Yeah.
I remember when we had kids that were in the elementary school, the different programs and what they were called. So is this going to be called the gifted and talented program, or will it not be labeled? You know, there used to be the clusters and stuff.
We still have
yep. So two different programs we're talking about, actually. Right. The cluster program is still for our high readers at this point. Mm-hmm. It's just that we're incorporating different data in that. Once we develop this and determine exactly what this is going to be, we may morph them. But right now, we have an early learning gifted and talented program, and we have a cluster program. But they're different. But one's K-2 and one's 3-5.
So it's like you're accepted into the program then for the gifted and talented?
For that year.
Labeled?
For that year.
Okay.
Yeah.
I remember at one point there were parents that were very in tune to the labels.
Oh, yes. And there still are. Yeah. But, it really is about supporting those kids at the level that they're at.
Yeah.
And providing support for those teachers. It's gone well. Again, very infancy stage still, so.
So is it currently just they spend a certain time of each part of each day within the program, or?
Yep. So RTI is we have an RTI schedule. So RTI is meeting the kids at their level. We've got a good robust program for the kids that are below grade level or at grade level. But then also we want to support those kids that are above grade level. Mm-hmm. And so it's the same amount of time that those kids are being pulled up for the kids that need support, but also the kids that are above being pulled at the same time. So they're not missing any core instruction. Everybody's, getting instruction, specifically interventions at their level at that time, both reading and math.
Okay. So.
And just quickly, getting back to the curriculum review process in this situation for science, I think it's kind of interesting to understand that. I think you had mentioned, Derek and Jen, it's like maybe a 7-year cycle process, that it might be good for 7 years. It may be more, maybe less than that. But they're also, depending on what you do, you may have books for just that class alone. It doesn't go to all the students, so you're not paying for books for everybody. It may not be 80 kids, it may be, 25, something like that. So just to give you an idea that they seem to have they've got a good handle on it and that they're going to do the review process. And Jen and Derek seem like they have a good idea which ones to go with at this time, but they're going to look around and see what the outcomes are for other schools as well. So that are using them.
They're a busy meeting. Mm-hmm. Anyone else? We had a finance meeting last Tuesday or Monday, and the topic of conversation we'll discuss more at the December meeting when Jeff Seeley comes in. But the topic is we've got some bonds that are probably maturing early in 2017, and it probably looks like it's in our best interest to refinance those or refund those earlier than that time. Certainly, we are close to an all-time low in our interest rates. Rob's nodding his head because he knows this from the private sector.
It's not going to last forever.
But if we wait until they mature and take our chances at the interest rates will be there, I think we're gambling on that. And Jeff Seeley will come in and... at our finance, we kind of narrowed it down to about three different options we thought were in our best interest. Beth, Dan Massett was there as well from the bank. Jeff and his person, young lady that was there to assist him. And they're going to bring us back three alternatives on those bonds and probably look for us to make some decisions shortly after the December 17th meeting. I think it'll be a net gain for us financially. And certainly if we wait, we're rolling the dice that interest rates are going to stay the same or even lower, and that ain't going to happen. So more at that meeting, but that the refunding dominated our meeting. So
no, he meant December 12th. Don't panic.
Did I say December?
You said 17th. That's he meant the 12th.
I don't know what I meant.
We're not coming on Saturday.
Yeah.
Sure.
Then I'll be by myself, I guess.
I saw Nora looking.
So any other information?
I've just got a couple things. MSBA, Lori sent out a nice note on December 8th. They are having the phase one. I will probably be going, haven't heard from Katie what she's chosen to do. Or you can do it right before the MSBA conference. That kind of gets to be a long week by the time you do all that. So being that they're going to offer it in Rochester, it might be a good refresher course for all of you. We are closing on Wistito finally on Friday. We've got a time and a place, and it looks like everything's in order. I do need to let you know that we did have to go ahead and quiet the title. We tried probably every other option. I even drove to Red Wing to work with the Historical Society. I mean, we certainly tried to take all the cost-effective measures we can. Once again, Rob was a great help, and so was Jim Burkhart, just remarkable. But we are going to have to spend anywhere between $5,000 to $7,000 to quiet the title. It really is just one of those mysteries that happen when you have things from very, very early in. And the last thing is that we will have one of our board members is going on January 8th. With the new Apple TV, we're hoping to have, it's Rob, his mug up on there so that he can log in from his location. But I do have the procedures. Kurt, you tried to do it once, I think, when you were on a trip and it didn't work. So it may not, but we will try to make that work for you. Depends on your location, to be honest. But those are the three items I have. So
Rob is able to join us via?
Well, he's going to try. Kurt tried it one other time, too. It isn't the easiest thing in the world to do, but we'll try.
We had a guy at WeTech did that. He goes to Arizona for 6 months, and he Skyped in on the ITV room when we're down at Sonoda. Yeah, Skyped in, and big as life, and yeah, just like he was there.
We do have to post it, your location, so that if anyone happened to be on the same cruise as him and wanted to join in, it has to be a public setting. I've got all the rules that Lori will follow very diligently, but just thought we should let you know that, too. So if there's anyone else coming up on vacations or anything, please let me know if you're going to be. Give us enough warning is what I'm trying to say.
Not poolside either, by the way.
Right, right.
It's public. It's public. Ocean in the background.
Anyone else? Let's at least congratulate them at some point in time. Mm-hmm. Okay, public input. Does anyone wish to speak to any items related to the school in any way about any topic? If you do, please be careful of the content. And you can read that paragraph yourself. You got up to 3.5 minutes. Anyone wish to speak? That's closed. Consent agenda. These items are normally considered routine and will be enacted under one motion. In the event a board member wants to discuss any item, it'll be removed. So I don't know if this is a removal time or not. You see the three things, the minutes, the resolution to accept gifts, and the personnel items. My question to anyone would be that acceptance of gifts, a statute, you looked into that at one point in time. It just seems like a $5 donation. Is that ever something that we could amend to our own needs? For instance, wouldn't $100 be more appropriate than a $4.99?
That's probably the attorney question more than anything. I don't know if we can amend the statute.
She recommended that if you're going to, you should really observe them all, even if it's $1.99 or not. Yeah. But yes, you're right. It does get quite cumbersome. It's a lot of work for Lori. But her recommendation was if you're going to do any of them, to do them all.
Can people be anonymous in their donations?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So if they don't feel like they have a need to say, gee, I did this for the school.
We've actually had a couple of those that have come in and been anonymous.
That was $5 or more.
I think it was $5 or more. Yeah, you're right. You could probably take the $4.99 off.
Too late now.
Yep.
Okay. I'll make a motion.
Motion by Jerry to accept the consent agenda.
I'll second the motion.
Seconded by Rob. Any other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That's carried. We have no old business. Under new business, consideration to approve the dance team fundraisers, Dancers versus Cancer. January 14th. Gene?
Yes, so very similar to what you approved last month with the girls' basketball team, wanted to do a coaches versus cancer. The dance team, without even knowing the basketball team was going to do one, approached me a day or two later, asked if they could do dancers versus cancer. There is a dancer whose mother is battling cancer right now, and all the proceeds would go to that family for them to do with it as they wish. Again, just like girls' basketball, everything goes to charity, and they would sell T-shirts. I don't think girls' basketball sell T-shirts, but they would sell some items and then also ask for donations at the gate for their January 14th meet.
I make a motion to approve.
I'll second the motion.
Motion by Brenda, seconded by Rob. Other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Carried. Update on the energy savings.
Well, I just really wanted the public to know. I know I sent out a really nice email to all of you and was pretty excited to get $70,835 in a rebate, but it gets better. I got a snapshot today of another check that we received. It'll be deposited tomorrow. We get another rebate check of $57,281 from the elementary. Our energy savings plan is well ahead of plan. We've just started kicking in using our natural energy, the help me out, you just approved it. Natural gas, thank you. Some of that is kicking in and we're already below, but also the temperatures have been really nice out. So that one's a little hard to read. Our diesel usage, again, is continuing to just be extremely low. Some really great things are happening, but these rebates especially, Xcel Energy has just really come through on everything they promised and more. And it's just an attribute to every single one of you were a part of approving that. And so hats off to all of you for making a really good decision to do the upgrades, because to get these kind of $70,000, $57,000 back in rebate checks is pretty phenomenal. So.
Yeah, I don't think you're going to see them next year.
No, we won't. But
no, I mean, they're restructuring the rebate amount.
They are, and we did this at the right time. You know, I was excited to even bring this to you. I was even more excited that you seemed so receptive of it. Dave heard some really great things about it, and to move forward with this has just been a really great thing. So we're pretty excited. Everything's fallen into place, and the solar stuff is really coming together. I mean, it's just kind of waiting for the bad call to come in, but so far it's been all good.
It will always come.
That's right.
Yeah, for sure. Okay.
Good job.
Yeah. Item number three is a Keith Meyer Scholarship. It says here one award of $500. Beth, would you like to speak to that?
Yeah, they've approached us. They'd like to do one award this year, the $500. It'll be from Keith Myers, the financial planner that we all know here in town. I would encourage you to approve this.
I'll make a motion to accept the Keith Myers Foundation Scholarship grant.
I'll second that.
Motion by Rob, seconded by Kurt. Other discussion? All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Carried. You flip that over to the other side.
And this one is just our local Cannon Falls Smiles. They are not only doing two awards of $500, but they are helping families here in town with some health care and dental care and things like that. So just a really strong thank you to this company for coming in and helping so many of our kids. And on top of that, adding a scholarship or two scholarships of $500. I would again strongly suggest you approve it.
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Kurt, seconded by Brenda. Other discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Carried.
Thanks, girls.
So we're just down to the informational. I was asking Beth, whispering to Beth about our Ed Foundation gala, and I think more recognition to come later, but it was an extremely upbeat meeting, and tears from many, many people in that room. Yeah. Our history with that is the Ed Foundation, for every dollar they take in, they use a third of it to pay current requests. They put away two-thirds. And we're in excess of $700,000 until that evening. And that's well on the plan that we had for, at one point in time, it was going to be the $1 million. And a very moving speech by Kathy Brecken talking about her life history with her aunt and the relationship between aunt and mom. But really moving, and I thought, where's this going? And photos of family members. And in that $500,000 donation from the Ed Foundation to the Ed Foundation, which probably is yet to transition, but certainly is on that way. Very impressive, you know. And one thing we always remember is the Ed Foundation is kind of an arm of the school, not directly under our jurisdiction, but certainly their process improves or is for our students to enhance themselves and for donations to enhance our programs that we can't otherwise afford. So I just wanted to acknowledge them at the meeting. It was very impressive, good crowd of people, and other donations were made that night as well. But
and the only reason why I think Brenda and I, we haven't got the official email yet, the totals, and we're still kind of waiting on a few things, so I didn't want to give out inappropriate numbers. I know I've written some thank you notes already. I don't think people understand that other Ed Foundations come and look at ours and try to model what we're doing here. It is just an absolutely remarkable thing. I look at my 16 years in this district and the things that I had in my classroom and things they've donated. There is no way we would have had without them. It's just everything Bob said and more. Yes. It's just remarkable, everything they've done. So Brenda's on that committee, I'm on that committee, and when the email comes through, I can't wait to share everything with you and kind of celebrate all over again. It'll be fun.
It's to the point where the Ed Foundation is imploring the staff, bring us stuff that up before outside of the box. We can do this now. So just a note to the principals, keep it coming, keep encouraging.
When we talked about starting one of our the January board meetings down by Pliscott's room, because they have purchased some lasers and some things now that, I mean, we have state-of-the-art situation going on down there, but he wants it to really get it perfected before you guys come down and see, but we thought we could start one of our meetings down there and then come back down here in January.
It's not done last week.
Yeah. And again, we try to make at least a commitment to put on the elementary school and have one of our board meetings down there. I think we should attempt to get that done in the next couple meetings, and Derek can host us.
He can bring cookies.
Pizza. So if you take a look at the next board meeting, we have a bevy of things that we're going to discuss. More about Jeff Seeley, the truth and taxation hearing, our audit presentation, levy certification. We're going to be busy, and it is the 12th, so we'll have to remember that.
There's only one that month.
So any other wishes that you might have, you can certainly run through Beth or Lori and see if we're able to squeeze it in. Having said that, anything else for the cause? If not, I would look for a motion to adjourn.
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Jerry.
I'll second.
Seconded by Kurt. It's a real good informational meeting tonight on just about all fronts, so that was fun. All in favor of adjournment, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? We're done.